Welcome, everyone. I'm Susan Harris. You are at NANOG 22, and this slide shows you where we've met in the past. The white stars are our meeting locations. And thanks to Rodney, this is the second time we've actually met in the Scottsdale Phoenix area. The red circles on the map are population areas graduated in size, and the blue lines are. Any guesses? No. Interstate Highway System 1990. Well, it's so strange. Some of your heads are like going that way, some are going. And they're really weird things. I have no idea what's on those screens. I'm just assuming all is well, right? So if something odd appears, let me know. I am from Merit Network, Inc., which is a nonprofit based at the University of Michigan. Merit is governed by all of Michigan's four-year public universities, and we connect those schools plus most of the state's K-12 schools and a lot of other organizations to the Internet through our regional network, MissionNet. NANOG's ties with Merit began during the era of the NSFNet backbone service. This was a project we led on behalf of the National Science Foundation. Merit's partners in this project were IBM, which supplied the network nodes, MCI, which supplied the circuits, and together we built the first national T3 backbone infrastructure. And in the course of this project, Merit staff traveled around to the various regionals connected to the network and met to discuss operational issues. Those meetings were called the regional techs. In 1994, ISPs had begun to emerge. They began to come to the meetings, which got bigger, and the group decided to recharter, and hence NANOG was born. NSF continued to support our meetings for a few more years until 1997. By that time, they had withdrawn almost all support for operations in the Internet. So now we're funded by you through your registration fees, through the many organizations that contribute, and through our hosts, like Rodney. And here are the smiling faces of our previous leadership. They're all here. We'll be buzzing around here in a meeting. Your beepers and cell phones should be turned off now, please. A couple of logistical notes. This is the announcement, like, I never really want to give. This is the bathroom announcement. But I know that you do not know that that door over there underneath the green exit sign actually works. It is a door. And when you go out and go to the right, you'll find the spa or whatever with bathrooms. So that's that. And as I was exploring this morning, actually, as I was getting lost on the way back to my room this morning, which is weird because my room is only about 10 feet from the pool, I saw there's a beauty salon up there. I know a lot of you came with your families, which is great. So some of your partners might be interested in that. It's up on the second floor on this edge. As we go along today, please keep an eye out for the slides. They will magically appear before each presentation, except for Rodney's, which are not linked off the web. No, they're not. So you'll have to actually watch Rodney's presentation. I mean, you'll see it. Oh, never mind. Please ask questions. Do not hesitate to stand up and embarrass yourself in front of all of us. When you do that, be sure and introduce yourself so we know who you are. And when you do that, do not tap on the microphone and say hello, because the people in back are watching you and the microphone will come on magically when you go up to the mic. We hope that everyone will be a good citizen today and use the Squid Cash. We have a ton of bandwidth coming into the hotel, but even with that, you will get lower latency to your hosts with the Squid Cash. You'll get more bandwidth to overseas sites with the cash, and you'll see the load on those servers as well. The person who's been doing our squid caching for the past year or two is Dwayne Wessels, and he's been doing some analyses of squid traffic from the past couple of meetings. Those analyses are linked off the web, off the network page. And you'll see there that on average you get to your host almost twice as fast when you use the cache as when you don't. We have a V6 connection. Bob Stovall is the person back there who's waving, and he's the second from the right as I'm looking at the back, and he's ignoring me. Bob is our V6 guru. We can help you if you have any questions about that. Static IPs are up in the training room. Do not even think about running DHCP on your laptop, please. You'll confuse everyone. This afternoon, our attendee survey goes live. Please fill one out. We take your advice to heart about what you thought about this meeting, what you would like to see in the future, what you thought of the topics, the speakers, and so on. So please do help us out by filling that out. Be in here at 5:30. We all look forward to that. It's in the same room as our party was last night. And just after that is the Internet Routing Registry BOF. Thank yous are hard at Nanog because there are so many people who contribute, but I want to particularly mention Cisco and the University of Oregon, who have been doing our multicast broadcast for the past several meetings. By the way, you'll notice today that you're not going to be able to get multicast from inside the room, but everybody out there in the world will be, just not us. Packet pushers is Dwayne's home for our squid cache. PAC supplied a wonderful breakfast for us this morning. We appreciate that. ASTA is providing our break this afternoon. There are many other local companies who Rodney is going to talk about who made huge contributions to the meeting. Last night's party, again, absolutely unbelievable. Kojin, thank you so much. And I haven't even met the three guys who are here, so come introduce yourselves today. Kojin also, hi, oh, that's Ed, that's Andrew. Uh-huh, thanks, DJ, for that tip. Kojin also threw a party for us in D.C. last fall when we had an entire pub to ourselves. Last night we had an entire lavish dinner. Thank you so much for doing this. It was a lot of fun. Rodney, the impresario of Arizona, is next. Rodney, what?
One.
Okay. Ah, that's your slide.
Yeah. Thanks very much. Obviously, welcome to Scottsdale, not quite Phoenix, but the nicer part of Phoenix. First of all, the network overview that Susan insists that everyone know about, it is actually pretty interesting. One of the biggest problems that I had when I agreed at very short notice to host this Nanog is the issue of connectivity. This is one of many hotels in Scottsdale, reasonably old, and no fiber, copper only. The last time that I hosted Nanog was about 3 or 4 years ago, and a T1 was all that we needed. This year, the requirements were for at least 10 megabits. There's 6 megabits used for multicast, and 4 megabits for you guys, assuming to use the squid cache. So we had some challenges. There's no easy way of, and this isn't a big knock, but we're in U.S. West territory, and that means that you look at 6 to 9 months to get fiber in, and obviously there's a significant cost, so we had to find another way of doing it. Let's start off, first of all, with a local network. I know there have still been a fair number of complaints. One of the problems is that unlike California, Arizona, everything, or most of the things are built of rock and stone and concrete, and so it's very difficult to provide wireless everywhere. We have three wave lands, or aeronet bridges in this room alone. We have one inside the terminal room, one outside the ballroom, and one in the lobby. And believe it or not, the lobby is, as you know, about 40 feet from the bar. However, there are big concrete pillars. We haven't been able to solve that. The hotel was a little unhappy about running Ethernet along the marble floor. So we're stuck with what you have there. We also have one antenna that we put up on the top of this roof. It's a 9 dB high-gain antenna that is connected to a wavelength. And so those of you who are getting coverage in your rooms, the reason you're getting coverage is because of that internal antenna. We've also had a couple of reports from the city of Tempe. They are logged into the system also, and they're enjoying the connectivity. But into the rooms through the concrete, it's not that easy. The external network is mostly black art for us. There's a lot of hesitation about using wireless and microwave. However, in this particular case, it was the only way we could make things happen. Keep clear of the antenna. Up on the roof, you guys can probably get a look at it if you want from the engineering guys. This is Alec Peterson, and Alec is still young and virile and not very bright. So that's Alec having a look at the microwave. This is the far end through a telephoto lens. It's about a mile away as the crow flies. It's a building on, as you go down Scottsdale Road, if you're heading to Old Town Scottsdale or to the Fashion Square on the right-hand side, a building was the only one that we were able to find, and I'll get into the circuit itself, but it would have turned out to be a very important building for us. The antenna itself, to the right of the top of the little building, you can see something sticking out. It may look like trees of that size, but that's the other end of the microwave antenna. Just some logistics, it actually is freestanding on a patio. The patio of the CEO of Fenova, his patio door has been open for 3 days now, will be open for another two, with duct tape keeping the weather out, and the cable runs through his office and up into the core space and then to a telco closet. Statistically, I'm not sure if it's easy to see this, but in terms of errors we've been running, we came up, by the way, Friday evening, 5 o'clock. So we've been live for about, 60 hours. So far on the entire thing, we've taken 6 input errors, 1 CRC and 5 overrun, and those were probably birds that happened to go between the path. But besides that, we did have rain Friday night, no degradation whatsoever. So it didn't affect us. So it's a DS3, 18 gigahertz, I believe. It's about a mile. The equipment itself comes from Advanced Techcom, where they're the manufacturer. The equipment is actually located at the back of the forum over here, as you face it, the right side of the main AV stage, so if you want to have a look at it. One thing I will say is it came up almost flawlessly. The only problems we had were actually running cables, but once they had the cables up and the antennas up, it wasn't very long and we were slinging bits with no problem. We then go on to an OC12 circuit provided by AT&T that goes to Camelback, along Camelback back to TCG, the old TCG facility, and then down to ASU. ASU have, I believe, OC12 fiber between between TCG and their facility. ASU are multi-homed. They have ATM and also OC3 to, I believe, Quest, Windstar, and Abilene. I may be wrong about that, but I believe those are the three. So if you see some odd routing, it's really coming from the mix of those three. These are people I wanted to thank for all the work that was done. One thing I will tell you, it's not easy to put on an analog. I learned that 3 or 4 years ago. It was much easier when I still owned Genuity because we were sort of an ISP and sort of a telco and we could get things done in Phoenix. Even then, we had a couple of hundred employees. It was reasonably difficult. Cenegate has only 16 employees and we're not an ISP, we're not a telco. It's very, very difficult to do it on our own. A number of Phoenix companies stepped forward without hesitation to help. The first one, I'll do it in order of the technology we use. CSG Wireless, a local wireless company out here. They've been around since, I know of them, since 1994. Ken McLeod, Rich Gonzalez, Gary Christensen, and Dan Waters, some of whom are here today. You may see them around. If you do, you may want to talk to them about the wireless technology. Very interesting. They also go up to OC3, and has some very successful OC3 implementations. Finova is the financial company in Chapter 11, which made it more difficult. They can't do very much. They own the building and the facility that AT&T's fiber came into, and the fiber's also in there just for them. Once again, a really important thing, don't ever deal with the corporate executives. Start off with engineering. You get lots of things done that the corporate engineers, that the corporate people know nothing about. So I'm sure the CEO of Finova is wondering what experiment they're running, what they're doing to help their financial situation currently. But Bill Letizia, Randy Mancibo, and Mike Fontaine, they'll probably be around later this evening. If you see them, go up to them and say thank you. Without them, this would have been impossible. They had the only building that AT&T could find, line of sight, where they had facilities. Talking about AT&T, we can mock AT&T as much as we like. I have to tell you that about 2.5 weeks ago, we started the conversation with AT&T when it looked like the original plans weren't going to work out. Without paperwork, without an order, without fuss, while we were on the phone, Brian Peters, who's the local manager over here of AT&T Local Services, looked at the system, built the circuit almost while we were on the phone, and then sent a couple of guys out to connect the ends. Jay Carlin, who's the local director, didn't hesitate to give us help. So AT&T really stepped up over here, and without AT&T, this wouldn't have happened. ASU Connectivity, Bill Lewis, who's the vice proctor, Daryl Eschbach, Joe Askins, and Scott Gardner, Scott with the routing and the multi-brand side. All of the connectivity you're getting is thanks to them. And I think at least Scott and Joe are here today. Wiring, network engineering design. A couple of guys that came out of, I believe, Mindspring and Atlanta, worked over here for a while. Danny Pitt and Nate Hollinger, all of the wiring you see, they've been here since Friday laying wire. Not very easy to get around this hotel. The hotel is not wired for Cat 5, so everything you see was fresh laid. Interesting thing about this, Nanon, you may have noticed, very few wired hubs, all at the back. There's a message. In future, bring the wireless, because my guess is this may be one of the last Nanogs where you can actually plug in. Get 802.11 and you'll find life a whole lot easier. So they had an easy job with that. I think there were about 120 ports all at the back. If there's somebody at the front who's wondering why there's no Ethernet, it's all in the back section. This particular Nanog, you'll notice the design's a little different. I learned from 4 years ago, and I've learned from the other Nanogs I've been to, and hopefully you'll notice the differences. The room is obviously much bigger, but it's been used, I think, reasonably well. When people walk behind you between rows, you don't have to get up or breathe in. Lots of room between them. I assume that you're happy with the power that you've got. No one's short of power. There are quad outlets, 4 for every 3 people. So if you're running some kind of Quake server on the side, there's plenty of power and plenty of bandwidth. The terminal equipment from Motorola. Once again, no hesitation. We had some equipment at Cenegate. Some of the people are here today from Cenegate, so we borrowed a couple of Unix boxes and re-OS'd them. But the rest of the stuff and the screens came from Motorola, Bill Austin, Jim Harrigan, and Larry Grebe. Cenegate folks, not that easy to spot. One of the suggestions I might make is that one of the future Nanogs have a way of perhaps a different color T-shirt for the hosts. So it's easy to, number one, go up to them and ask for help, and number two, go up to them and thank them. These are people who obviously have volunteered. They get paid for during the week, but not for weekends. The setup is all over the weekend. So these are some of the names. I'll read them very quickly, and we're almost done. Lisa Tilton, who's my assistant, who really coordinated just about everything. And when you checked in, she was up at the desk in the front. Lisa Gregg, who wrangled all of the technical side. Alec Peterson, all of the routing. And then Nick Main, Todd Goulet, Kevin Mayer, Jay Dinnenbein, J.D. Austin, Eddie Williams, and Bob McClure. We'll get to Bob in a second. Kim, Rachel, Carol, Audrey, and Des are some of the girls who saw upstairs at the desk. One of the questions I was asked was, what about Plan B? So we actually did have a Plan B. RFC 1149. So, fortunately, we didn't have to use them. They're sitting waiting in case the system goes down. But with the 6,000 second round trip times that we saw, it's not going to be much fun. So, with that, welcome to NAMO. Just the last thing was on Bob McClure. Bob is a retired engineer. He's on the board of SCO, and he took it on upon himself to do the design work. So the T-shirt design comes from Bob. It was also Bob's idea to have the Nanog grog. So there's something different. It was specially brewed from a local brewery over here in Phoenix called Rio Salada Brewery, a great microbrewery. And it's the beer is available throughout Nanog, all as a result of Bob McClure. So hopefully you guys, if you see Bob around tomorrow, he's out of the country at the moment, you'll say thanks to him. Welcome to Nanog and enjoy the rest of the show.